W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Drums in the Distance, Journeys into the Global Far Right by Joe Mulhall, narrated by Finlay Robertson. Introduction. It was roughly 8 a.m. when I entered the Wetherspoons pub at Stansted Airport. As I waited at the packed bar, surrounded by stag and hen parties, I noticed a man to my right, who stood out among the groups of 20-somethings in fancy dress. He wore a Fred Perry polo shirt, black, with champagne twin tipping detail on the collars and cuffs, and an embroidered laurel wreath over his left breast. It was tucked neatly into bleached Levi's jeans, cuffs rolled halfway up his shins, held up by plain black braces with silver clips. Most striking of all were his cherry-red Dr. Martens boots, matched in their high sheen only by his closely shaved head. I scanned his arms for tattoos, the usual way to distinguish a racist skinhead from the non-racist original. Over his left arm, he had draped a classic maroon Merc Harrington jacket with ribbed cuffs and hem, flap-covered side pockets and the standard tartan lining, leaving just the bottom half of a crucified skinhead tattoo protruding. Inconclusive. However, as he reached out his right arm to pay for his drink, a large, odal rune tattoo came into clear view. The symbol, originally a letter in the pre-Roman runic alphabet, was adopted by the Nazis, used by some Waffen SS divisions, and subsequently embraced by post-war fascists. As if further confirmation were needed, he was joined at the bar by a group of similarly dressed skinheads, one of whom, the bravest, or perhaps the stupidest, was wearing a white t-shirt emblazoned with a hooded figure atop a white steed rearing up on its back legs. Above it was the unmistakable logo of the Ku Klux Klan. I instantly knew they were going to the same place I was. Warsaw. It was November 2018, and I was on my way to Poland with a colleague from Hope Not Hate, the British anti-fascist organisation that we work for. We were to attend the Polish Independence Day demonstration, a huge event that has become a major date in the calendar of the international far right. We were to infiltrate the demonstration, photograph international attendees, and report back to London with our findings. My colleague had overslept and was in a taxi frantically winding his way to the airport, so I finished my drink and made a swift exit from the bar to board the plane without him. As I entered the cowshed-like structure that passes for a departure gate at Stansted, my chest tightened as I practically tripped over a group of activists from the British branch of the far-right youth movement Generation Identity, GI. By chance, they didn't notice me, which was lucky, as my Hope Not Hate colleagues and I had spent the past year attacking them in print with a series of damaging exposés. I hid behind a newspaper and began to sweat as the realization struck that I was to be locked in a confined space with a menagerie of racists for the next 2.5 hours, with no escape should one of them recognize me. I wasn't particularly worried by the pubescent GI crew, but the 15 or so inebriated skinheads were a different matter altogether. I made a last-minute decision to get on the plane regardless, boarding last but one via the rear door. My colleague dived aboard as the doors were closing, and thankfully we touched down in Warsaw without incident. The sight that greeted us as we stepped onto the tarmac was staggering. Rows of planes emptied out hordes of far-right activists from around the world, alongside Polish nationalists returning for the celebrations. The events of the next 48 hours were the perfect embodiment of the nature of the contemporary international far-right. Traditional nationalists, representing various political parties, were joined by Nazis, who prioritized race above nation, alongside activists from modern transnational far-right movements such as the alt-right, the identitarians, and anti-Muslim counter-jihadists, all reported on by right-wing alternative media outlets and live-streamed by the new breed of far-right social media influencers. Hate has gone global, and this demonstration proved it. By 10 the next morning, the streets around the Palace of Culture and Science, the vast brick edifice that towers over central Warsaw, had already begun to pulse with red and white flags. Most of the crowd wore Polish flag armbands. The young girls had red and white flowers in their hair. The young boys' scarves and hats were proudly adorned with the Polish eagle. It looked like any other national celebration, with patriotic families and friends gathering to commemorate the centenary of the restoration of the country's sovereignty in 1918. Yet look a little closer, and a more sinister picture emerged. Some wore scarves emblazoned with the white supremacist version of the Celtic cross, while others streaming out of the metro station sported odal, rune, and Nazi SS black sun tattoos on their arms and faces, sometimes partly obscured by skull face masks and balaclavas. The crowds began to gather in earnest from around midday at the Domowski roundabout. As nationalist songs blared out across the closed roads, groups huddled around a green gazebo, the roof of which bore the green, crooked arm and sword logo of the National Radical Camp, Obóz Narodowo Radikalny, ONR. The trestle tables were loaded with badges, stickers, T-shirts, bandanas reading Good Night Left Side, with an image of one man stamping on another, and a selection of books including what looked like a self-published Polish language version of Norman Finkelstein's notorious The Holocaust Industry. The men taking the money wore balaclavas, combat trousers, bomber jackets and black Dr. Martin's boots. The National Radical Camp is a fascist group named after an anti-Semitic organisation of the 1930s, well known for being the organiser of numerous marches in Myślenice, a town in southern Poland, to mark the anniversary of the anti-Jewish riots in that city in 1936. Joining them as co-organisers of the demonstration were all Polish youth, a virulently homophobic far-right youth organisation whose motto is youth, faith, nationalism. They erected their own gazebo adjacent to that of the ONR, raised their own triangular flags, a sword on a green background, and began to distribute stickers and leaflets. As the 2 p.m. start time grew nearer, ever larger groups of balaclava-clad men gathered, and the first of countless red flares was lit. The city echoed with the sound of exploding bangers, making demonstrators jump and flinch. What started as a trickle became a flood as people burst out of every tributary road, alleyway and metro station. The police presence was inconceivably small, with just the odd group of officers scattered around, albeit with pump-action shotguns and strings of cartridges across their chests. This demonstration was marshalled by the far-right organisers themselves. The roads along the route were lined by all Polish youth activists, faces covered, red electrical tape around their arms to identify them, some wearing military helmets and protective glasses. The ONR had a flatbed truck with a PA system over which call and response was demanded of the crowd. In the distance, I could hear the faint pounding of a bass drum to keep the chants in time. At far-right demonstrations, you often hear the sound of drums in the distance well before you see them. Then the Polish national anthem boomed over the loudspeaker and the crowd, by this time tens of thousands strong, exploded into rapturous song, countless red flares lighting up the grey November sky. People let off fireworks that exploded over the heads of the crowd. The march was about to begin. The week prior to the march had been an uncertain and tumultuous one for the organisers. Just days before it was due to take place, the mayor of Warsaw, Hanna Gronkiewicz-Waltz, banned the demonstration, citing the likelihood of violence and hate speech. Just hours later, Poland's president, Andrzej Duda of the Law and Justice Party, announced that the Polish state would organise its own demonstration at the same time and along the same route as that planned by the fascists. Negotiations ensued, and a deal was struck between the Polish authorities and the far right, meaning the president and a small state contingent would march first, closely followed by the main demonstration behind. As the march was about to start, Duda climbed onto the back of a green military-style jeep, took the microphone, and addressed the enormous crowd before him, now easily over 200,000. As he looked out, he would have seen the massed flags of the fascist ONR, the green flags of the All Polish Youth, a large contingent of flags of the Italian fascist group Forza Nuova, and a sea of skinheads in bomber jackets. This didn't stop him. Despite our thick heads after a night out in Warsaw, my colleague managed to climb atop a bus stop from which to film. I lacked the agility and made do with a high wall from where I deployed my long lens. Him on film, me on stills. So large was the crowd that it took 3 hours for the demonstrators to all file past the start point. By the time they had, the city was cloaked in darkness, illuminated only by the mass of red pyrotechnics. Alongside Polish and Italian fascists in frighteningly large numbers were a host of other international figures. The notorious British anti-Muslim activist Tommy Robinson, real name Stephen Yaxley Lennon, had been due to speak but had cancelled several days before, though two of his associates attended the event and appeared to be working alongside the racist alt-right Canadian YouTuber Stefan Molyneux. We also spotted several British vloggers with pro-Tommy Robinson high-visibility jackets, as well as British activists James Goddard and Tracy Blackwell. Also in attendance was the American citizen journalist Jack Pisobic of the Alt-Light, the section of the alternative right preoccupied with culture rather than race. The march flowed down towards the Poniatowski Bridge, over the wide Vistula River and past the National Stadium. Hundreds of bangers were dropped over the edge of the bridge and down into the archways, exploding with mighty cracks that reverberated up through the floor. The flares and smoke bombs covered us in ash and burned our eyes. Once over the bridge, we flooded into the park behind the stadium. As far as the eye could see, there were hundreds of thousands of people waving flags. At the centre was a large stage from which two priests led prayers, followed by more political speeches. To left and right on an embankment were the massed fascist flags of the All Polish Youth and the National Radical Camp, an image reminiscent of Nuremberg in the 1930s. Masked men ceremoniously burned the flag of the European Union. While many of those on the march were not neo-Nazis or fascists, and were there merely to celebrate the independence of their country, the presence of the far right was so ubiquitous that no one could pretend they didn't know who was running the event. Despite this, they were happy to march alongside them, listen to their speeches, and join in their chants. The president himself marched just meters ahead of the fascist flags, no doubt in earshot of the ONR drummer. Apart from some small running battles between attendees and stewards to the right of the stage, the day passed in relative peace. Yet that did not make it any less terrifying. The numbers were bigger than expected, dwarfing those of the previous year, and the nonchalance with which fascists were treated, and the willingness of the president to strike a deal with them, only confirmed the increasing normalization of the far right that we are seeing across the globe. The night finished with a firework display and more singing as the crowds slowly dispersed. Back at the Palace of Culture and Science in central Warsaw, the streets had already been cleaned, and traffic once again bustled through the streets. When I first got involved in anti-fascist politics back in 2010, it was inconceivable that just a decade later, over 1.9 billion people would live in countries with radical right governments. As of 2020, this included three of the five most populous countries on Earth, with the United States under then-President Donald Trump, Brazil under President Jair Bolsonaro, and India under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. In Europe, President Andrzej Duda and Prime Minister Maciej Morawiecki, both of the Law and Justice Party, govern Poland, while Hungary is ruled by Prime Minister Viktor Orban of Fidesz. Meanwhile, The radical right is in parliamentary chambers across the continent and part of several coalition governments, including those of Bulgaria, Estonia, Italy and Slovakia. Elsewhere, parties like the Swedish Democrats, the Austrian Freedom Party, Alternative for Germany, the Danish People's Party, Vox in Spain, and the Finns Party in Finland have all achieved success at the ballot box. Simultaneously, we have seen the rise of new transnational far-right movements like the alt-right that have embraced the internet and rewritten the manual of far-right activism. Recent years have also seen a wave of tragic far-right terrorism on a scale I couldn't have imagined a decade ago. At the time, I had just finished university and was renting an illegal sublet in a council flat near Gospel Oak Station in North London. I spent my days on a camp bed in a comically tiny room with no television and dreadful internet, eating tinned peaches and listening to Dave Brubeck's Time Out on repeat. The boredom was punctuated by playing in what I thought at the time was the greatest band ever, inexplicably called Mad Moon Sea. Listening back to the demo tapes now, it's clear we were punishingly mediocre, and only occasionally in time, which is not ideal, as I was the drummer. Nowadays I am often asked, when meeting new people and telling them what I do, how did you get into that? I always wish I had a dramatic and inspiring reply like, I read Mandela's Long Walk to Freedom and it changed my life, or I cried when watching children from different backgrounds playing together at a multi-faith bake sale. The truth is that I fell out with the singer and was kicked out of my band, leaving me jobless, on benefits, and confined to a room in which I could touch all four walls without moving. I just needed something to do, and so I applied for an unpaid internship at Hope Not H, HNH, campaigning against the far-right British National Party in Dagenham, Essex, at the upcoming general election. I obviously didn't know it then, but that decision completely changed my life. In the decade that followed, I went from delivering anti-fascist leaflets door-to-door to infiltrating a heavily armed far-right US militia group, where I was handed a shotgun and sent to the Mexican border. Hope Not Hate's job is to monitor and disrupt the activities of organised hate groups, and as a researcher, I have infiltrated organisations on both sides of the Atlantic, attending hundreds of far-right events in the UK, Europe and North America. By being on demonstrations and inside meetings, we'd get unparalleled information on their plans and internal workings. But we also get to spend time with activists, learning what motivates them and their hateful politics. I'd be lying if I didn't admit that there is a real buzz to this type of research. The addictive adrenaline and Moorish terror of being there among the firecrackers, police charges and clandestine meetings. Later, as my undercover days came to an end, there were the long sleepless nights that came with running operations, terrified for friends and colleagues who are now taking the risk instead. There have also been moments of immense and affecting sadness, like meeting a woman, cold and shivering on a dusty concrete floor in Zacco, northern Iraq, who had just had a miscarriage while fleeing the advancing ISIS forces. Or the sense of utter uselessness one feels when being begged for help by migrants desperately trying to cross the Mediterranean from Tangier to Spain. Of course, it's not all been scary or sad. For every depressing and tragic moment in this job, there is one of joy and inspiration. Being hugged by refugees, excitedly taking their first steps on the beaches of Europe. Hearing stories of successful resistance or the resolve displayed by young Indians demonstrating against discrimination in Chennai and New Delhi. This book weaves 10 years of infiltrations and operations for Hope Not Hate into the much more important story of the rise of the global far right over the past 50 years. It uses personal stories and insights as a way into understanding the scale of the problem we currently face and to shed light on the people behind it. Over the past decade, I can point to victories and proud moments when I feel I really made a difference. But the truth is that we are now losing. When I started campaigning in 2010, we set out to stop the far-right British National Party taking control of a council chamber, and after one of the largest anti-fascist campaigns in British history, we were remarkably successful. The years that immediately followed now feel like halcyon days when we moved from victory to victory. At one point, the threat of the organised far-right was so small that I left Hope Not Hate to do a PhD. At the time, my anti-fascist activism was usually viewed by friends and family as earnest but unnecessary. In a post-9/11 world, the usual view was that I should have been focused on Islamists rather than the irrelevant far-right. Sadly, no one thinks that anymore. One of the reasons people have started to take the threat more seriously in recent years is the bloody rise of far-right terrorism. Among the worst-hit countries has been Germany, which has seen a string of terror attacks. In October 2019, a far-right terrorist killed two at a shooting in Halle, Saxony-Anhalt, with a further 9 people killed in February 2020 in 2 shootings at shisha bars in Hanau, Hesse. These came off the back of the extraordinary events surrounding the activities of the National Socialist Underground that included the murder of 9 immigrants between 2000 and 2006, the killing of a police officer in 2007, and 3 bombings in Nuremberg in 1999 and Cologne in 2001 and 2004. Sadly, Germany is by no means the only country to have been struck by far-right terrorism in the last decade. In Norway in 2011, Anders Behring Breivik mercilessly shot 69 people on the island of Utøya and killed a further 8 people with a van bomb in Oslo. In the US in 2015, Dylan Roof, a white supremacist, murdered 9 African Americans at a mass shooting at a church in Charleston, South Carolina. More recently, there have been 2 anti-Semitic mass shootings. First in October 2018 at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, killing 11, and then at Poway Synagogue, California in April 2019, killing 1 and injuring 3 more. These were followed in August 2019 by the slaughter of 22 more innocent people at a Walmart store in El Paso, Texas, in an anti-Hispanic attack. The UK has by no means been exempt from the killings, with the murder of Member of Parliament Joe Cox in 2016 and a van attack on a mosque in Finsbury Park, North London in 2017. There would likely have been more bloodshed were it not for the brave work of Nazi-turned-anti-fascist Robin Mullen alongside my HNH colleagues Nick Lowles and Matthew Collins, who together stopped the murder of another MP by members of the banned Nazi terrorist group National Action in 2018. The deadliest attack in recent years came on the 15th of March 2019, when a far-right terrorist burst into Friday prayer at the Al-Noor Mosque and then the Linwood Islamic Centre in Christchurch, New Zealand, killing 51 and injuring a further 49 people. The killer, an Australian, was inspired by the actions of British terrorist Darren Osborne, Swedish school murderer Anton Lundin, US church killer Dylan Roof, and Norwegian mass murderer Anders Breivik. His manifesto showed that his ideology was derived from the ideas of British fascist Oswald Mosley and the so-called 14-word slogan, popularised by the US white supremacist movement. He also flagged historical reference points popular among the international anti-Muslim counter-jihad movement and was motivated in large part by the key tenets of the European identitarian movement. Before his attack, he had spent time in France, Croatia, Bulgaria, Hungary, Turkey and Bosnia-Herzegovina, all of which influenced his politics. Among the victims that day, alongside Muslims from New Zealand, were migrants and refugees from Pakistan, India, Malaysia, Indonesia, Turkey, Somalia, Afghanistan and Bangladesh. The Christchurch attack was a truly international tragedy, perpetrated by one man, but motivated by a global movement. Many of these terror attacks were carried out by individuals not associated with traditional far-right political parties, but rather part of looser, often transnational far-right movements that lack formal structure. While all these groupings have formal organisations within them, they are often post-organisational. Thousands of individuals all over the world offer micro-donations of time and sometimes money to collaborate towards common political goals, completely outside traditional organisational structures. These movements lack formal leaders, but rather have figureheads, often drawn from an increasing selection of far-right social media influencers. For most of the post-war period, getting active required finding a party, joining, canvassing, knocking on doors, dishing out leaflets and attending meetings. Now, from the comfort and safety of their own homes, far-right activists can engage in politics by watching YouTube videos, visiting far-right websites, networking on forums, speaking on voice chat services like Discord, and trying to convert normies on mainstream social media platforms like Twitter and Facebook. The fact that this can all be done anonymously hugely lowers the social cost of activism. These new movements are best understood as a many-headed hydra. If one prominent activist or leader falls from grace, it is no longer a fatal hammer blow. Others will simply emerge, and the besmirched are discarded. Of fundamental importance is that these movements are genuinely transnational. While activists will generally be primarily preoccupied with local or national issues, they invariably contextualize them continentally or even globally. Often activists from all over the world come together for short periods to collaborate on certain issues, and these loose networks act as synapses, passing information around the globe. An Islamophobe in one country, outraged by the serving of halal chicken in their local fast food restaurant, can post on social media, and the story will spread through the network. If picked up by a super sharer, an especially influential activist with a large social media following, that local story will be adopted and then distributed by like-minded Islamophobes all over the world, and act as more evidence and further convince them of the threat of Islamification. All this means that if we are to truly understand the contemporary far right, we must change our thinking. We live in a shrinking world and are interconnected like never before. Our ability to travel, communicate and cooperate across borders would have been inconceivable just a generation ago. And while these opportunities are by no means distributed evenly, they have opened up previously impossible chances for progress and development. Yet greater interconnectivity has also produced new challenges. The tools at our disposal to build a better, fairer, more united and more collaborative world are also in the hands of those who are using them to sow division and hatred around the world. If we want to understand the dangers posed by the politics of hatred and division, we can no longer just look at our street, our community, or even our country. We must think beyond political parties, beyond formal organizations altogether, and beyond national borders. This book aims to do just that by telling the story of the far right from an international perspective, outlining its different manifestations, be that political parties, street protest groups, Nazi terrorists, or individual actors working online, and exploring the many factors contributing to their current rise. Among the personal experiences I will draw on are my infiltration of the US militia movement and the Ku Klux Klan, as well as attending meetings of major anti-Muslim groups and extreme alt-right conferences. In the UK, I've attended literally hundreds of far-right demonstrations and got inside extreme fascist meetings. I've been to far-right events in Sweden, Denmark, Germany, Poland, and the Czech Republic. And to understand the rise of Hindu nationalism, I travelled to India during a period of violent anti-Muslim riots. I've also handled infiltration operations for others, including that of my colleague Patrick Hermanson, who bravely spent 1 year undercover, the story of which became the documentary Undercover in the Alt-Right. Academic and journalistic research is invaluable for properly understanding the far right, but all too often they lie or moderate their politics when they know someone is watching. Sometimes it is only by getting inside these movements that you can really uncover the truth. I've also tried to better understand the drivers behind the rise of these movements around the world. I've spent time in the communities affected by far-right politics, such as Dagenham, Burnley and Stoke in the UK, and in the Rust Belt of North America. Exploring the effects of deindustrialization, globalization and economic hardship. Yet, economics alone cannot explain the mess we are in. Cultural and social factors also play a role. The so-called migrant crisis undoubtedly had an important effect on the rise of the European far right, and in 2015, I travelled to the Greek islands to witness it firsthand, spending nights on the beaches meeting refugees and migrants as they took their first steps on European soil. More recently, I returned to the Mediterranean, meeting with migrants in Morocco, hoping to do the same. Finally, there is no way of telling the story of the modern far right without exploring the role of Islamist terrorism. The wave of Islamic terrorist atrocities since 9/11, and especially the spate of attacks in recent years, have lit a fire under the international far right. While some have oversimplified the relationship between the far right and Islamist extremism, there undoubtedly is one. For many years, I researched the UK terrorist group Al-Mahajirun, attending dozens of their demonstrations in London. Many of the people I met at those events, including their leader Anjem Chowdhury, went on to be convicted of terrorist offences. Others headed to Syria and Iraq to fight for the Islamic State, and many died there. In 2014, I followed them with a trip to northern Iraq, a few months after the dramatic fall of Mosul. Together, these stories, some published previously by Hope Not Hate, but all revised and updated, will not only add colour, but will also, I hope, contribute to people's understanding of the current threat. The variety of individuals, parties and movements discussed in this book, ranging from Donald Trump to Nazi terrorists, raises the question, how can they all be called far right? Debates about terminology, whether it be far right or fascism, have spilled a staggering amount of ink and filled much bigger books than this one. While far right is a very broad term, those within it are united by a common set of core beliefs. Jean-Yves Camus and Nicolas Le Bourg point out in Far Right Politics in Europe that far right movements challenge the political system in place, both its institutions and its values, political liberalism and egalitarian humanism. They feel that society is in a state of decay, which is exacerbated by the state. Accordingly, they take on what they perceive to be a redemptive mission. They constitute a counter-society and portray themselves as an alternative elite. Their internal operations rest not on democratic rules, but on the emergence of true elites. In their imaginary, they link history and society to archetypal figures and glorify irrational, non-materialistic values. And finally, they reject the geopolitical order as it exists. Though far right is a useful umbrella term, it is necessary to split it further into its constituent parts, the democratic radical right and the more extreme far right. The social scientist Cass Mudder explains that the far right rejects the essence of democracy, that is, popular sovereignty and majority rule, while the radical right accepts the essence of democracy, but opposes fundamental elements of liberal democracy, most notably minority rights, rule of law, and separation of powers. While that's a useful distinction, it is worth noting that even much of the radical right's acceptance of democracy is tactical or performative. Most, but not all, on the radical right can also currently be described as populist, which Mudder defines as a thin ideology that considers society to be ultimately separated into two homogeneous and antagonistic groups, the pure people and the corrupt elite, and which argues that politics should be an expression of the volonté générale, general will of the people. Another important term is the perennially difficult to define fascism, which makes up a part of the far right. But what is fascism? Even 22 years after Mussolini had seized control of Italy, George Orwell identified the difficulty of distilling a single consensually derived definition, asking, why then cannot we have a clear and generally accepted definition of it? Alas, we shall not get one, not yet, anyway. Unfortunately, we are still some way off consensus, despite the emergence over the last 20 years of a field often called fascism studies designed to achieve just that. One issue is the widespread misuse of the term. During the so-called Free Speech Week events organised by the British far-right provocateur Milo Yiannopoulos in California in 2017, the campus at Berkeley echoed to the sound of anti-fascists chanting, "No Trump, no KKK, no fascist USA." Placards, posters and leaflets littered the streets, many of which unequivocally called Trump a fascist. Trump is many things. He is a racist, a misogynist, a nativist and far right, but he is not a fascist. In the words of the historian of fascism, Roger Griffin, you can be a total xenophobic, racist, male chauvinist bastard and still not be a fascist. Of course, none of this is new. As far back as 1944, Orwell lamented, it will be seen that, as used, the word fascism is almost entirely meaningless. In conversation, of course, it is used even more wildly than in print. I have heard it applied to farmers, shopkeepers, social credit, corporal punishment, fox hunting, bullfighting, the 1922 committee, the 1941 committee, Kipling, Gandhi, Chiang Kai-shek, homosexuality, Priestley's broadcasts, youth hostels, astrology, women, dogs, and I do not know what else. However, despite the slovenly bastardization of a deeply serious term, the word fascism has not been debased beyond usefulness for the classification of political individuals or organizations, despite what some historians argue. As Robert O. Paxton rightly states, the term fascism needs to be rescued from sloppy usage, not thrown out because of it. It remains indispensable. We need a generic term for what is a general phenomenon. Some reject the term, arguing that fascism died in 1945 with the fall of Nazi Germany, while others go even further and argue that its use should be confined to Mussolini's Italy. Gilbert Allardyce, for example, argues that fascism is not a generic concept. The word fascismo has no meaning beyond Italy. However, as Graham Macklin explains in Failed Führers, while the epochal conditions ceased to exist after 1945, and post-war fascism lacks the broader economic and existential crisis from which it derived its significance during the interwar period, this does not mean that post-war variants have ceased to be fascism. Neither the frequent incorrect use of the term nor the diversity of the phenomenon is cause enough to discard it altogether, though all of this makes it extremely hard to define what we mean when we use the word fascism. However, the conundrum of defining a sprawling, diffuse and deeply varied historical phenomenon with a single term can be overcome by the adoption of an ideal type. Of the numerous ideal type definitions, the closest to have achieved a consensus is that provided by Roger Griffin, who defines generic fascism as a genus of political ideology whose mythic core in its various permutations is a palingenetic form of populist ultra-nationalism. While this may all seem academic, it is not. Who we call far-right or fascist is important, as it has ramifications for both the state and anti-fascists alike. Lumping everyone together with the term fascist results in some seeking to combat Nigel Farage's Brexit Party with the same tactics one would use against a Nazi terrorist group. How we understand and define elements of the far right is the first step to working out how to oppose them. Many thought the march towards progress and equality was one way, but the past decade has shown this is not to be the case. Around the world, we are witnessing the return of the far right, posing a genuine threat to many of the rights and freedoms we had begun to take for granted. While this has been uneven and by no means universal, there is a worrying direction of travel that can be seen in several continents simultaneously, and in many countries around the world, the very pillars of liberal democracy are beginning to wobble. The differences from country to country are, of course, as numerous as the similarities. There is no monocausal explanation for what we are witnessing. Yet while the rise of the right in each country has its own drivers, rooted in unique histories and experiences, there are international similarities that help shed light on these troubling times. The better we understand the threat we face around the world, the better we will be able to fight back. I hope this book will contribute to that exercise of understanding. Chapter 1. From the British National Party to Brexit. I was standing on the opposite side of the road to a police station with an extendable paint roller in each hand. It was dark, and the roads were now quiet, but our plan was already starting to feel a little underdone. At any moment, a police officer could walk out of the station and ask us what we were up to, and I certainly didn't have a believable answer. A touch of nighttime decorating, perhaps? Not sure that would wash. I was in front of a huge British National Party, BNP billboard, attached at ground level to the outside wall of a terraced house. "People like you voting BNP," it read, with a picture of an idyllic white family. My friend Cookie was behind me, holding a 10-litre tub of brilliant white matte emulsion paint. The plan was simple. He would throw the paint on the billboard, and I would use the rollers to distribute it, after which we would jump in a third friend's waiting car and make our getaway. Conscious of the proximity of the police station, we knew we had to be quiet and fast. What could go wrong? I faced the billboard, rollers at the ready. "On three," I whispered. "One, two, three." Before I could finish, 10 litres of paint had hit me on the back of the head. I turned in disbelief to my buffoon of an accomplice. "Sorry, it slipped," he said sheepishly. I turned to look at the billboard. We had managed the seemingly impossible. It was completely untouched, not a drop on it. I, on the other hand, was covered from head to toe. Starting to panic, I turned myself into a human roller and slid my body left and right across the billboard, smearing as much paint on it as possible. My mate took the roller, ran it up and down my back and then onto the billboard. I had essentially become a paint tray. We did what we could and then ran to the waiting car. "There is no fucking way you are getting in my car." "What? You're not getting in my car covered in paint, no way." "Are you joking? There's literally a police station right there." "You'll ruin my seats," It's already a shit car. I'm getting in. Do not get in. I'm getting in. Do not get in. I jumped into the car with a squelch. Drive the fucking car! Our little operation hadn't got off to an ideal start, so we moved on to the next billboard while arguing about who would pay for the destroyed upholstery. The next advertising board was an altogether harder proposition. Instead of being at ground level, it was up high. To reach it, we had decided on the ingenious plan of filling cheap plastic pint glasses with paint, covering the tops in masking tape, and throwing them as paint bombs. We pulled up next to a vast billboard that ran alongside the A13 motorway. One side was for the BNP, the other was a UKIP sign reading, 5,000 new people settle here every week. Say no to mass immigration. Cookie picked up one of the pint glasses and took aim before hurling it up at the sign. However, instead of smashing, it bounced, and I looked up to see a pint glass filled with paint heading straight for my head. Surely not. Not again. I dived out of the way just in time, the pint glass whistling past my face and smashing on the floor next to me, once again, covering me in paint. I looked up at a pristine billboard and then down at my paint-spattered legs. I think we should call it a night. Throughout the post-war period, the British far right's ability to exert influence beyond the confines of the political fringe has depended on its cohesiveness and size. While it is unwise to measure the threat of the far right purely in terms of electoral strength or number of feet on the street, it only takes one right-wing extremist to bomb a pub or murder an MP, its ability to influence mainstream political debate, especially on issues like immigration and integration, has generally been tied to the relative importance and scale of political parties and street movements. Since 1945, there have been cycles of unity and division that correspond to periods of relative influence, decline, and obscurity. In 1948, 51 far-right and fascist organisations merged at a meeting in Farringdon Hall, London, forming the Union Movement, UM, under the leadership of the notorious pre-war British fascist leader Sir Oswald Mosley. Though officially lasting into the 1990s, the UM, which encountered fierce opposition, remained noteworthy for just a few years before fading back into obscurity. 1967 saw a second period of coalescence, with the formation of the National Front, NF, following the merger of the League of Empire Loyalists with the then British National Party and elements of both the Greater Britain Movement and the Racial Preservation Society. Though never achieving mainstream support, the NF became a household name during the 1970s and was a fixture on the political landscape, peaking in 1979 when it stood 303 candidates at the general election, only to have the rug pulled from under it by Margaret Thatcher's infamous 1978 television interview, in which she said, "British people feared being swamped by immigrants and by the intensity of campaigning of the anti-Nazi League." A period of splintering and decline in the 1980s followed as a result. On the 7th of April 1982, a rival far-right party emerged, muscling in on the political space previously occupied by the NF. With time, it grew into the most electorally successful fascist party in British history. The British National Party, BNP, was formed by John Tyndall, who brought with him former activists from the NF and his splinter group, the New National Front. As well as personnel, there was a continuity of politics, with explicit racial nationalism remaining the central pillar of the party's platform. So much so that in 1986, Tyndall and the editor of the BNP's newspaper were both sentenced to a year in prison for conspiracy to incite racial hatred. While the BNP stood in elections throughout the 1980s, it remained a party of the streets, best known for provocative and confrontational marches. At the end of the decade, they launched a Rights for Whites campaign that sought to exploit growing racial tensions in multicultural communities, exacerbated by the economic and social turmoil unleashed on industrial towns by a decade of Margaret Thatcher's rule. Their first electoral breakthrough came in September 1993 with the shock victory of Derek Beacon as a councillor in the Isle of Dogs, a large peninsula in East London bordered on three sides by the winding River Thames. The victory became a blueprint for the BNP, which benefited from local anger over decades of neglect following the decline of the once mighty docks, combined with a local housing crisis blamed by many on the growth of the local Bengali community. Demographic change and economic decline were a potent mix, and the BNP were always ready to provide easy answers to complex questions, a tactic that saw them emerge as a terrifying electoral threat from the turn of the century onwards. In 1999, the party leadership changed hands with Nick Griffin, a long-time fascist from Barnet in North London, who had joined the National Front aged just 14, graduated from Cambridge, and had a history of extreme racism and Holocaust denial. He had joined the BNP in 1995, becoming the editor of two extreme publications, The Rune and subsequently Spearhead, where he built a reputation as a hardliner who argued that we need to take political people and convert them into thugs. In 1998, his extremism landed him in trouble with the law when he was convicted of inciting racial hatred and received a 9-month prison sentence, suspended for 2 years. It is perhaps surprising, then, that Griffin went on to become the great moderniser of the BNP, the man who led the British far right out of the wilderness and into the European Parliament. With one eye on the success of the modernising project undertaken in France by Jean-Marie Le Pen's Front National, Griffin sought to make the BNP a more viable electoral option by altering how it presented itself, if not its core beliefs. While this was correctly criticised by many anti-fascists as a superficial transformation, it began to pay dividends at the ballot box. Though remaining a racist, anti-Semitic and homophobic political project, the party began to professionalise both its image and its structures. A move encapsulated in its decision to finally drop its policy of compulsory repatriation for non-white people. Griffin understood that being labelled as anti-Semitic and racist was the primary hurdle to gaining mainstream success, so much so that in July 2001, the BNP even launched their Ethnic Liaison Committee, designed to organise publicity activity with non-whites who have expressed favourable sentiment towards the BNP, all designed to break down the media image of the BNP as racists. Hence, in the early 2000s, the BNP publicly jettisoned the more explicit elements of its traditional anti-black racism and shifted towards what they felt was a target more likely to garner public support: Islam and Muslims. The BNP's decision to change the focus of their racism towards a different community is nothing new for the British far right. Throughout the whole post-war period, the far right have sought out an other, a target of their ire, on the back of which they hope to secure wider public support and gain entry into the mainstream of domestic politics. In the years immediately following the Second World War, the British far right was still obsessed with its traditional enemy, namely Jews, a target that, in the post-Holocaust age, only served to isolate them further from the mainstream. However, as public hostility towards the arrival of non-white immigrant communities grew, large sections of the UK far right shifted their attacks onto the new arrivals. By the 1970s, the far right was ready to seize any available political capital by targeting whichever community they felt would garner the widest public support. One only has to take the briefest look at how the far right reacted to the arrival of Ugandan Asians in 1972 to understand how immigration shot up the agenda between the late 1940s and the early 1970s, with their realization that it was the issue that could help them break out of their post-Holocaust exile. The National Front, then Britain's leading far-right party, greeted Prime Minister Edward Heath's compassionate decision to grant asylum to many Ugandan Asians with a ruthless but astute political campaign. The result of the NF's swift opportunism led to a rapid swelling of their rank-and-file membership. The next shift came in the 1980s, when the primary target of the far right slowly began to move from all immigrants, with an emphasis on anti-black racism, towards a more specific anti-Muslim politics. Matthew Collins, former NF organiser turned anti-fascist, pinpointed the Salman Rushdie affair as the moment this shift occurred. Salman Rushdie's book was when the far right first saw Islam and all its challenges. And that's never happened since then. It's always been about Muslims since then.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.